and rose again. Turn with me, please, to Romans chapter number 10. Thank you again for allowing us to be part of your conference. Thank you for the wonderful meal. I was trying my best to not eat too much before I get up and preach. I don't think I was that successful. And I know I got to preach preach better tonight so that you stay awake after that meal. But I've got spitballs back here so I can catch anybody that's fallen asleep. Amen. Romans chapter number 10, and let's read verse number 13 through 15. The Bible says this: "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Aren't you thankful for that verse? I mean, that verse I've used almost every person I've witnessed to since being a Christian, and what an amazing truth. The simplicity of salvation, the good news of Jesus Christ, that if you will just put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ and turn to Him, He will save you. "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." The gospel is such good news. It's so simple, and it's such an amazing truth. And the next verse then piggybacks off of that truth. And look what it says in verse 14. "How then shall they call on Him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in Him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher?" The simplicity of the gospel is so profound and so amazing, but what good is it if they don't hear it? Someone once said the gospel is only good news if it gets there on time. And Paul here is a missionary himself, and that's he's sent out of the church at Antioch. He goes from many places around the world. I mean, if anyone qualifies as a missionary, it's the Apostle Paul, going into unreached, unnamed places of the world where Christ has not been named, and preaching the gospel. And so you see his heart for missions coming out here, his desire to see this message, the simple message of the gospel, go out. And he asks the question, how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? Now, this is what we would call a rhetorical question. We all know the answer to this question. He's not asking, not knowing the answer. The answer is, they're not going to. They're not going to be saved if they don't hear this simple truth of verse 13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." And then verse 15, he continues, "And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things." And that's what this conference is planning and organizing, and the battle plans are being drawn, and things are happening because we want to send missionaries into the harvest fields so that people can hear the gospel message. We all know the Great Commission and Jesus' command to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And here Paul the Apostle is pleading with churches to, hey, we need to send missionaries into the harvest field. Now, the gospel is entrusted to every generation, and throughout the church history, as you study, you see great missionary movements, and some have been mentioned already in this conference. We've heard of the Moravian missionary movement. We've heard of possibly even some of the great missionaries that we know that have gone to the field, like Adoniram Judson, William Carey, Hudson Taylor, and throughout the generations, there have been many missionaries that have gone to the field, and missions has gone out, but every generation is responsible for reaching their generation with the gospel. Yeah. And our generation is responsible as well, and it's not enough that 100 years ago we had great missionary movements. It needs to continue today in 2024 as well. Yeah, and we can't just rest on those past victories. And in the time of the writing of this verse, there was approximately 300 million people on the earth. And today there's just about to hit 8 billion. And so we see that our generation in 2024, we need to take an account, how are things going in the modern missionary movement? And in asking that question, one of some things that have been interesting is I've been on furlough for the last 3 months, and even before that, asking questions and talking to different people. There's some interesting things that have been going on in the modern missionary movement here in 2024 that I think we should take note of. One man did a survey for all of the major independent Baptist missionary boards and found that 2023 is on record now as one of the lowest, if not the lowest, year for new missionary recruits applying to be accepted as missionaries. It's been personally alarming for many pastors. I've heard many conversations with pastors all over the country over the last 3 months, and usually when I go to a church, we'll have a meal or something, and usually this conversation will come up and we'll ask. And then I've noticed in almost every case, the pastors have told me, I have noticed a very sharp mark and decline in the number of people that are contacting us for deputation. Mission boards have seen that number decrease of missionary applicants, and it's becoming alarming that how few new missionaries are coming on the field. And we know this, that missionaries are coming off the field and new missionaries need to be replacing them. In Bible colleges and Bible institutes, the same statistic is becoming true. Dr. Don Sisk, I'm sure many of you have heard him preach. He's an amazing example to me in his 90s, preaching the Word of God. He's been a pastor. He's been a missionary. He's been a missions board director, worked at a Bible college. And so he's had a lot of different experience in that area. And I was in a missions conference with him last year. And he said that, we were talking about this in the car on the way back to the hotel, and he said, Brother Putney, he said, it's just been interesting. When I was, back in my day, 20 to 25% of Bible college students that were graduating were wanting to go into missions. That doesn't mean they all got to the field, but they were wanting to go into missions, and now it's something like 1% or less. And I think that it's very important that we understand, as Pastor DeMichael said on Wednesday, very, very great message. This church cannot reach the whole world with the gospel of Jesus Christ, and all generations have experienced a tremendous need in missions. But I do think that we should take note that we can compare ourselves with just a couple generations ago, and it's not going in the right direction. And we can understand that something is possibly needing to be lifted up, especially with the population of the world exploding and moving forward. And so tonight I just want to offer just a few simple points. The title of the message tonight is How to Save the Modern Missions Movement. How to Save the Modern Missions Movement. And if you're taking notes tonight, I just want to give you a few simple points that we can all do in all of our churches throughout the United States. Every Christian can take part in at least a number of these, personally and collectively as a church. And I think that if we were to do so, we would see a marked improvement in the condition of modern missions in the year 2024. So let me give you a couple of these tonight, and then in the time we have remaining. The first one is very simple. Pray. Pray. Look with me, please, at Matthew chapter number 9. Matthew chapter number 9. I know that my message last night was on prayer as well, and we are to pray for the missionaries, and we heard about that last night. But in specifically, when it comes to sending out missionaries and reviving the modern missionary movement of 2024, the number one thing I believe we can do to affect this and to help this improve is pray, and pray specifically that God would send missionaries all around the world. Matthew chapter number 9, verse number 38, the Lord Jesus Christ says, we know these verses, let's look at verse 37 first. Then saith he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. And then notice his command here. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. This is the direct prayer request of Jesus Christ in the scriptures to the church. This is his prayer request. We all have prayer requests and prayer request time, and our church does that in Columbia, and we have on Wednesday nights, we'll get together and people raise their hands, pray for this, pray for that, and we pray for those requests. But Jesus Christ himself had a prayer request. And his prayer request was, pray that God would send laborers into his harvest. His heart is for missions. His heart is for sending laborers into his harvest. And prayer will, as it helps the missionary on the field, prayer will make the difference in us being able to send new missionaries to the field as well. I mentioned last night in the message about the Moravian prayer vigil that went unbroken for 100 years, someone in the church praying 24 hours a day for 100 years, and how that spread, how that sprung out the missionary revival of the Moravians, and how they were able to send out from a group of 300 people over 65 years, send out 300 missionaries from a small church of 300. It's just amazing what prayer does, folks. Hudson Taylor, we know of Hudson Taylor, the great missionary to China, and in his books, if you read his biographies, you'll find that he went to China and God used him mightily to win many people to Christ, but then God broke his health and he had to come back to England, and he lay in bed in England unable to get out of bed, just feeling worthless that he couldn't be in China winning people to Christ. And he realized God had a purpose for it, and he spent his days praying for missionaries to China. And all of a sudden, people started showing up at his door. Is this where Hudson Taylor lives? I'm interested in missions for China. Can you help counsel me? Can you help me? And that led to the creation of the China Inland Mission, and that led to hundreds of missionaries going to China. And you see that really, Hudson Taylor's greatest impact on China was not him himself being there, but his pleading with God and praying that God would send others to the mission field as well. He that was his burden, and his prayers made that difference. Prayer makes a difference in coming to, in God sending laborers to his harvest field. I believe every single one of us should pray every day, Lord, please send people to the mission field. Now, God has to call an individual to go to the field. I believe that with all my heart. I believe you need to be called of the Lord to go. And I would not try to persuade anyone to go who God has not tried to call. I would not try to pressure anyone to go to the mission field or anything like that. I know that God has to call you to go. And if he were to call you, you would know it, because you would know that if I do anything other than go, I'm going to be in disobedience to the Lord. That's what a call is. That's how you know it's not just a burden. If I don't go, I am in disobedience. That's a call. And God needs to call people to the mission field. But can I tell you, sometimes I feel we can have a Calvinistic viewpoint on that call of God. Can I see what Christ is saying here? He wants us to pray that God would call more people. You know, you understand what that means? We can affect the God of heaven with prayer. We can, through prayer, in many ways, affect what God chooses to do. Isn't that amazing? When we pray, God, the creator of the universe, listens, and he hears those prayers, and he hears our intercessions, and he decides, you know, I'm going to do what he asked me to do. I'm going to change that. And can I tell you, Jesus is telling us to specifically ask God to call people and send people to the mission field. And so this is something that I think we need to understand. You can say, oh, God's just not calling people like he used to. We can ask him to, and we can change that. I'm somebody that, I'll be honest with you, I was very surprised when God called me to the mission field. He called me to the mission field when I was 18 years old. I had zero inclination towards missions before that. Zero. I'd been to the Dominican Republic. When I was there, I had zero inclinations towards missions. And then God called me to the mission field, and all of a sudden, that changed. And I don't know all of these things, but can I, maybe somebody was praying. Maybe I would have ended up just becoming a mechanical engineer like I was planning on doing, and then God called me, and all of a sudden my life changed. Maybe someone prayed and said, hey, Lord, we need some missionaries. And the God of heaven said, yep. I'm gonna touch this guy right here. You're going. I go, what? All right, let's go. And I don't know. But can I tell you, the Bible is clear here. We are to pray that God would do that. And so we can look around and we can say, hey, where are all the missionaries? Why is it that we have so few missionaries going out? And why is it that generations past had such greater push for that? And we can pray that God would change it. Amen. And our intercessions can change the actions of the creator of the universe. And he can say, yeah, you're right. I'm going to call some of these Bible college students over here. Because these guys over here are pleading that we need missionaries in this country, that country, this country. Ye have not because ye ask not. How many of us truly are pleading every day with the Lord for his prayer request that we need to send laborers into the harvest fields? If we're going to revive the modern missionary movement, if we're going to improve things as from where they are now, we must pray to the Lord of the harvest that God would send forth laborers into his harvest. Fervent daily prayer. You know what I believe will happen if we do that in our churches in America? Things are going to begin to, God's going to be in touching hearts of young people all around. And this, just like he touched mine. And God's going to do a great work. Second thing we can do to revive the modern missionary movement is this: we can care. Care. Look with me, please, at 2 Kings chapter number 20. 2 Kings chapter number 20. First is pray, and the second is to care. You know the story in 2 Kings chapter number 20 of Hezekiah, and he loved the Lord, and he made some mistakes towards the end. He showed his treasures and all of the things that he had to the Babylonians, and the Lord was not happy about that. And so the Lord pronounces judgment on him in 2 Kings chapter 20, saying here in verse number 18, the Lord pronouncing judgment. We can back up to verse 17. Behold, the days come, 2 Kings 20, verse 17. Behold, the days come that all that is in thine house and that which thy fathers have laid up in store unto this day shall be carried into Babylon. Nothing shall be left, saith the Lord. And of thy sons that shall issue from thee, which thou shalt beget, shall they take away, and they shall be eunuchs in the palace of the king of Babylon. Then Hezekiah said unto Isaiah, good is the word of the Lord, which thou hast spoken. I bet you Isaiah was thinking, what? What do you mean good is the word? What do you mean, king? And then he says this, he says, is it not good if peace and truth be in my days? He didn't care, because it didn't affect him. This is what you call apathy. And apathy is the killer of modern missions in Christianity today. He was a good king. He loved the Lord, but at the end of his race, he just didn't care anymore. He had become apathetic, and he's hearing this news that, hey, all these your children and all this is going to happen. He's just saying, hey, you know what? It's been real. It's been fun. I'm fine. It's not going to happen while I'm alive. And apathy is such a sad thing, folks, because it just kills the work of the Lord. Right. We can explain to someone the great need for laborers today in missions, and we can preach about missions, and sometimes we can just kind of grow apathetic. And I believe this was mentioned in some of the messages as well last night. You know, Brother Dake was preaching about this as well, and we can just hear it so often that it can just kind of become, yeah, I've heard that before. I've heard that before. I've heard that already. I'm not moved by that emotionally anymore. But can I tell you something, folks? The Christian life is not based on emotion. It is based on truth. And the truth remains the same. Missions is our command to go into all the world and preach the gospel. That still is our marching order. I don't care if you're crying about it as much 20 years after you heard it for the first time. It doesn't matter. We can still move forward and do what Christ told us to do. It's true. But we can become apathetic. I remember preaching. Let me just give you an example. I've preached in a lot of churches. One church I was preaching in, just preaching about the need for missions and for laborers, and that God would, you know, and just pleading that the Lord would send laborers into his harvest. And the pastor got up afterwards, and he literally said this. He said, that's good for Brother Putney and all, but all of you here, your mission field's right here. And he just ended my entire message in one statement. And I understand that. God's not going to call everybody to the mission field, but is there anyone? According to that pastor, there's no one. Don't listen. And then contrast that with last Sunday, I was, or about a week and a half ago, I was at Pastor Gipps Church up in Lewiston. And I preached a message on the need for missions and laborers, and Brother Gipp got up to the pulpit and just stood there, and he had tears in his eyes. And he said this, he said, "I am so sick of people not going to the mission field." Can I tell you something? He cared. He cared. And if we're going to revive the modern missions movement, folks, we got to care as well.
Right.
We have to care. Apathy will kill missions. Apathy is often caused by being distracted. By being distracted by other things and not really having a vision of what is really important in the world. You know, sometimes, sad to say, we care more about our team making the playoffs than we do about laborers being sent into the harvest field. We don't run on emotion. We don't need to always have an emotional response every single time, but we can function on truth and do what must be done and pray every day and care every day and ask the Lord, "Lord, would you send laborers into your harvest field?" Apathy kills missions. Apathy can be frustrating when missionaries come back to the States. Last night we shared about some of the battles on the mission field. And I find it interesting. I love reading stories of World War II and other different battles and wars. And one book I read about Marines in the Battle of Okinawa, and just how terrible and brutal that battle was, just for months, just what they suffered through as they slowly took ground over the Japanese and the island of Okinawa as they were dug in, and men were just literally go insane from the shells exploding day and day and week after week. And they always talked about if you could get the million-dollar wound. And that was if you got shot somewhere where you weren't maimed for life, but you could get a pass back to the United States. And their buddies would get hit, and they would be injured and all, and then they'd say, and that they were going to live, and they weren't going to be maimed for life. And they would say, "Man, you got the million-dollar wound," and they would get a ticket back to the States. And what was amazing in that story is those after they recovered in the hospitals, they began to write their friends on the front lines there in Okinawa, and they would get the mail while they were still on the front lines. And they would read these letters, and the common thread in all of them was they said, "We want to come back to the battlefield," because they were amazed at the apathy of the people in the States. They had no concept of what was going on the battlefield, and they couldn't relate to them, and it drove many of them to re-enlist and go back to that point where they back to that place where they were so longing to just get injured so they could leave. Can I tell you, folks, that apathy is a horrible thing, and we need to remember that there's battles going on around this world, and we need to, as we spoke about yesterday, we need to pray for those missionaries. And we need to be part of the battle, even though we're not there and we don't see it personally. Missions trips are great for killing apathy. Missions trips are great for that. You can come down and you can see it for yourself, and people can go back and say, "You know, I never really understood missions, and I got to see it this last time." What a blessing that is. Let's not be like Hezekiah and just be content that we have the gospel and not care about all those who do not. Third thing we can do to revive the modern missionary movement: we can pray, we can care, and we can encourage. We can encourage. Look with me, please, at Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24. Hebrews chapter number 10, verse number 24. Hebrews 10, verse number 24. The Bible says this: "And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works." We are to provoke one another unto love and to good works. That is to encourage one another. We are to encourage one another in this area of missions. And I love the stories in the Old Testament where they're diligent to explain to their children what God has done, and biblical concepts and principles. When they crossed the Jordan River, they put up the giant the giant stack of stones so that they could say to their children, this is what the Lord did, and this is how we need to look at this, and this is how we need to think about this. And can I tell you, with our children, God can use so many of them to do great things for Him. And they're growing up, and I believe it's important that we encourage them to have the right concepts and points of view about missions. And we encourage one another to have the correct attitudes regarding the things of God, and especially in regards to the mission field and missions, and speak to them about just the importance of it, and let them have a heart for missions. Get them involved in Faith Promise from the time they're little. Let them meet missionaries. Let them understand what missions is all about. And as you're praying for laborers, pray that God would even use your children. Dr. Don Sisk, I've been in a lot of missions conferences with him over the years. And I remember one particular, it was probably 5 years ago. And he was preaching, pretty large church in Texas. And he was preaching just what I just said. He was talking about praying for laborers and pray that God would call your kids. And he said, you know, some people, they're afraid to pray that because they don't want God to call their kids. And they don't want to encourage them to consider missions. And he was preaching that way. After the sermon, he was sitting at the table. We were having dinner there at the church, and he was sitting there by himself. And I walked up to him, and I said, hey, Dr. Sis, thank you for that message. That was a blessing. And he looked up at me, and he said, well, I'm glad you thought so, brother. And I said, what's wrong? And he said, well, after I got done preaching, I went to the bathroom. I went in there into the stall. And while I was there in the stall, two of the gentlemen from the church came in, and they didn't know I was in there. And they just started ripping the message up one downside, down the other, and saying, how dare he say that about that? And they were upset about what he said about the kids' part. And can I tell you that I'm pretty sure that those men that were doing that after the service, they probably weren't encouraging their children to have the right point of view in regards to missions. In fact, they were probably doing the opposite. They were probably trying to encourage their children to do anything but missions. And folks, these attitudes are not going to help our young people take serious the possibility that maybe God would want to use them on the mission field. Do you understand that God calls the vast majority of people to the mission field while they're children and teenagers? God called me when I was 18. I'm almost too old. I'm almost in the odd range of elder of being older when they called a lot of people when they're younger. That's when God first begins to speak to their hearts. When my wife was a teenager, God touched her heart and called her to the mission field. And she knew from that time as a teenager that was what God wanted her to do. And I believe with all my heart, we need to teach our young people that being called of God to be a missionary, if God were to choose to do that in your life, it is the greatest job and privilege that you could ever have. Missions at times is a difficult road, but boy, is it ever worth it. It is ever worth it. I feel like it's a big mistake to speak of being a missionary as if it's some kind of condemnation to a life of misery in a third world country. It's not. But as I travel around the United States, people talk about it like that. It's almost like they pity missionaries. Or they pity missionary kids. And you'll hear this, they'll be said, hey, missionary kids, man, I heard this several times on this furlough. Man, your kids, man, they've got to have the hardest life. Missionary kids have it so hard. It's such a hard life, brother. And my kids are like, I feel bad for them that they're not missionary kids.
Yes.
Careful, your attitudes that you convey to your children. Boy, I'm sure glad that God sent Brother Putney to Columbia and not me, not my kids. Your kids listen to that. Can I tell you something? I feel bad for you. You didn't go to Columbia. I'm so glad God called me to Columbia. And I want God to serve him wherever he calls you. But boy, can I tell you, it is an error to present missions and to talk to missions in front of our children like it's this horrible thing. And then we wonder, why isn't none of our kids surrendering to the mission field? We're not praying for it. These attitudes are not only incorrect, they're harmful. Being missionaries is the best job in the world. If God were to call you to be a missionary, you would have the best privilege in the world.
Amen.
The fourth thing we can do is this. We can preach. God uses preaching to convince us of his principles and his word. The preaching of the word of God is powerful. And you were to take a survey of most missionaries in the world, I don't know the statistic, but I would be willing to say a large percentage of them, God called to the mission field during a preaching sermon, during a message. He did me. He did my wife. He did almost every single missionary I know, and I'm sure there's exceptions. But boy, folks, we better preach. We better pray, and we better preach. Count Zinzendorf, the leader of the Moravian missionaries, when God began to put his burden on his heart for sending laborers into the field, he was only 26 years old when all of this modern missionary, when the missions revival there started. And he preached with fervor one message, and 10% of the congregation, 26 men out of 300 in that congregation, men came forward and gave their lives to go to the mission field. God uses preaching to affect our hearts. The preaching of his word. How shall they hear without a preacher, our text says. And sadly, unfortunately, if we don't preach for the need for missionaries, we might miss out on some of that. I've been in hundreds of churches. I've been in many, many missions conferences. And can I tell you, when I was a kid, it seemed like I heard at every single missions conference an emphasis on, hey, we need people to go. Entire messages. And can I tell you, it's rare that I hear a message on and focused on sending laborers to the field nowadays. And when I get a chance to preach at a missions conference, usually that's my topic I'll go with because I know I will be the only one that'll do it. We need to preach, folks. Amen. God would touch people's hearts and that we could say, hey, Lord, would you use me? Prayer makes a difference. So does preaching. So does preaching. And we say, and as I said, I would not try to convince someone to go to the mission field that God has not called, but God uses preaching. And the Holy Spirit uses the word of God and touches a young person's heart and says, hey, there's people praying that God would send laborers in the field, and you're up, bud. You're in. I want you. Paul preached it. The Lord preached it. We need to preach it as well. Amen. And if we care, we will. Amen. If we're praying, it will become a topic in our sermons. And God will use it. The fifth thing we can do is we can send. We can send. Romans 10:15 in our text here says, how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. Once God has called someone to go to the mission field, they need to be trained, they need to be proven, they need to be encouraged, and when the time is right, they need to be sent. I'm so excited to be able to send our first missionary family out of our church next year. And can I tell you something? We're going to miss them. They've been in our church for 10 years, and they're people that when I need someone to fill in my pulpit, when I need someone to help me out with some kind of pastoral duty, they're available, and they're just such a blessing in our church. But boy, I'm so excited that we can have that privilege to be able to send them out. We need Bible institutes training. We need Bible colleges training people, preparing them so that they can be sent out prepared and ready. But what a privilege it is to be part of that model of Acts 13. Where God calls out and the church is able to send out the biblical model and being part of the Great Commissions, the Great Commission. We don't need knuckleheads on the mission field. And so therefore, God's going to call our best people. And it's going to be sad when they leave. And we're going to miss them. But can I tell you, God blesses. God's going to bless. And God's going to provide. Just as Paul and Barnabas. I'm sure they were missed at their church. But praise the Lord for the church at Antioch. They must be sent. They must, and then finally we'll finish with this. How do we revive the modern missions movement? We must pray. We must care. We must encourage. We must send. We must preach. And finally, we must go. Ezekiel 22:30. And I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found none. And this is the problem many times we have, is God is calling, but for many people, there are too few willing to go. And we, as we pray for laborers and we encourage and we care and we preach and we train and we send, in the end, there's going to be a number of us that God is going to say, hey, I want you to go. And I believe this with all my heart. Every single one of us, whether God's will is for us to be on the mission field or here in the United States, every single one of us should be willing to do whatever it is that God wants them to do. Amen. Right. God's will for me is to do something I can't even think of right now. I need to be willing and moldable. If tomorrow he is to just radically alter my life, I just have to be able to say, Lord, whatever you want. And the same for you as well. Someone has to step forward and sign up. Someone has to go. And God's will may not be for you to go to the mission field. But maybe it is. Have you ever thought of it? Have you ever prayed about it? Have you ever told the Lord, Lord, I don't know what you, I don't know, that I don't feel like you've called me to do that, but Lord, if you were to ever decide to do that, here am I, Lord. I'll go. Sometimes we think of the Great Commission as go them, not go ye. Here am I, Lord, send him. But in the end, all of us need to be willing servants of God and just say, Lord, whatever it is you want for me to do, I'll do it. Because I truly believe this, God doesn't just call people that are equipped to go to the mission field. I know I wasn't when he called me, but he equips the people he calls. And that means any single person in here, if God were to decide that was his will to send you to the mission field, you'd say, I couldn't do that. Well, you're right, you can't, but he can. And he can equip you. And he can change you. And he can make you and mold you as clay into what he wants you to be. And that's why the Bible teaches us in 1 Corinthians 1:25 that God chooses the foolish things of the world, the weak things, the things that are not, the base things, to confound the wise. You say, I remember when I was a kid, I didn't understand really how people could go to the mission field, and, you know, I didn't like to travel. I was kind of a homebody, and I kind of just figured missionaries were people that just love to go camping, you know? And that's just not the case. They're normal, everyday people that in many cases never would have thought they would be a missionary. And yet one day, God, in answer to prayer, says, hey, I want you to go. And then that willing heart, say, Lord, if that's your will, I'll do it. And then God begins to change them. Change them. I found this verse. The Lord says, delight thyself also in the Lord, and he will give thee the desires of thine heart. I found he changes my desires to his desires. That's how that works. And I have the desires of my heart, but wow, they weren't what I thought they were. Have you ever considered that? God want me to be a missionary. Young people, have you ever prayed, Lord, would you call me? It's God who decides who goes and who doesn't. It's God who calls. But I believe God wants to call more people to the mission field. Yeah. And I believe we should pray. I know we've all heard the statistics of before, but I will say this. 90% of all ordained preachers are preaching to 13% of the world's population that speaks English. And 87% of the world's population that doesn't speak English is working on the other 10% of preachers that are ordained in the world. And I believe that we can send more laborers to these forgotten places around the world. There are hundreds of cities in Colombia that do not have a church preaching the gospel to them. Who's going to reach them? Isaiah said, I heard the voice of the Lord saying, Who am I? Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then said I, Here am I, send me. You know, the Lord was giving that vision to Isaiah. And he's asking another rhetorical question. God is speaking to Isaiah, Whom shall I send, and whom will go for us? Do you think God didn't know who he wanted to send? He knew he wanted to send Isaiah. But what did he want Isaiah? He wanted Isaiah to be willing. Lord, I'm here. And maybe God will say, you know what? I appreciate you're willing. I want you to be involved in missions another way. But maybe God would say to some, maybe even here in this church, hey, you're up, bud. I want you to go and to reach some place that you've never been, you've never heard of, maybe a language you've never even considered or heard. And you can be part of that, taking that wonderful message. Whom shall I send? Whom shall go for us? Taking that message of whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved to these forgotten places around the world. And that's what Missions Conference is all about. Wherever God wants us, being there, but being willing. And for those that are not called to go to some forgotten place around the world, I'm sure we'll hear more about this on Sunday, but to be a witness and preaching the gospel to every creature here in the United States as well. Because all around us in this town are people that need to hear the gospel. And it's not just for the missionaries on the other part of the world. It's for every single one of us. But as far as the missions movement in general in 2024, let's pray that God would allow us to maybe have a missions revival today. Yeah. What a wonderful thing that would be. We read about them, but you know what? We can be part of that. Yeah. Let's pray. Let's care. Let's encourage. Let's preach. Amen. Let's send. And let's go. Amen. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for this conference. Thank you for this church. Thank you for their faithfulness, their heart for missions, Lord. Thank you for the wonderful night you've given us. We pray, Lord, that you would just use your word to touch our hearts. Help us to preach, Lord. Help us to pray. Help us to be faithful, Lord. To pray that you would send others to the field, Lord. That you would send laborers into your field. Lord, I pray for the young people. You'd touch their hearts. Lord, that you'd just help the church to have a spirit and an attitude in teaching them, Lord, about missions in a way where, Lord, you could just help them to have an attitude to just think, wow, what if God were to use me one day on the mission field? Lord, give us that heart. Help us to train these children. Lord, what a blessing it is to run into little kids that you've not called them to the mission field yet, but they say, I want to be a missionary when I grow up. Lord, help us to have that attitude. Help us to care. And Lord, help us to pray. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Pastor. Amen.